Well, if you have a Bible with you, turn with me to the book of Hebrews, first to chapter 2, and then to chapter 4, and in chapter 2, we will find our golden text for this whole series on Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 2. And the first four verses we've been using for our basic text because we find that it, or at least I thought, that it sort of reflected the whole tenor of the book. So I didn't really take a vote, but I guess y'all. Verse 1 says, "Therefore we must," everybody say must, "must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels," stop for a minute, when he uses the term the word spoken through angels, what's he referring to? The law, the old covenant. Amen. A little review here. "The word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him, God also bearing witness, both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will." Amen. So his question is, they had a covenant that came through angels and brought a revelation of transgression, and everything had a just reward. And if they didn't escape, how on earth will we escape if we ignore or neglect the amazing word or message that has come to us through the Lord Jesus Christ and was confirmed to us in so many different ways, including miracles, gifts of the Spirit, and signs and wonders. Amen. So we have been going from chapter 1 as he continues to emphasize the greatness of Son. You know, in the first three verses he said God has spoken to us in these last days by his Son, and whereas he spoke by the prophets to the ancient ones, but here in these last days we're hearing from God through his Son. Praise God. The Lord Jesus Christ is the imminent will of God in the flesh on the earth. And he demonstrated those things to us. But then he began to talk about Son, not just when he walked on the earth, but Son on the revelation side of Calvary, on the resurrection side of Calvary. There's a special essence of sonship that he brought about through his death, burial, and then his resurrection. And the bottom line is, on that, he let us in on it. Amen. We got to become sons on this side. Praise God. That's a pretty good deal. Amen. And he compared to Moses and began comparing just a little bit to Aaron in the incarnation that Jesus achieved a number of things. We talked last time about the entry into the promised land and then the entry or the failure to enter the promised land. And then he began to talk about entering into the rest that remains for the people of God. Remember that? That was a very quick synopsis of how long we've been doing that. So why didn't you just sum it up in the first place? We could have gone on about our business. But if you remember verse 8 of Hebrews 4, he says, "For if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remains therefore a rest for the people of God, for he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his." He's talking about the institution of the Sabbath back in Genesis when God ceased from his works. And if you will remember, we talked about the fact that God did not cease from his works because he was worn out. He ceased from his works because he was what? Finished, through, done, mission accomplished. And in the same way, we can cease from our works because the work of the Lord Jesus Christ is what? Done, finished, mission accomplished. Amen. Hallelujah. So we enter into his rest, and therefore we cease from our works. Are you with me so far? Okay. So we'll begin tonight in verse 11. I'm going to read the New King James. He says, "Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us, therefore, come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Amen. Let us be diligent to enter into rest. The word diligent, what does that mean to you? Hard work. Yeah, well, diligent means work hard, persevering, painstaking. Yes, so that makes the King James actually says, let us labor to enter into rest, which almost seems like an oxymoron, doesn't it? Let's work really hard to enter into his rest. That's always been an interesting phrase to me. The New Living Translation says, let us do our best to enter rest. I don't think they knew they were making a rhyme, but they did. Amen. Do our best, labor, be diligent, spudazzo. It means to be diligent, earnest, or eager. Let us apply ourselves and give our best effort to do what? Enter into the rest that Jesus has purchased for us. We apply our best effort to entering the rest. If we go back and look at the discussion up to this point, how did they get into the rest? The ones that entered the rest, how did they get it? Well, by faith. And then by joining themselves to other people who were living by faith according to the message that they'd heard. Amen. And then by obeying the word of God when they heard it. That brought them into rest. So we want to enter that rest. Being human, we tend to lapse back into our own works. It's amazing how quickly we rebuild the law for ourselves after we come to Christ. The rest he wants us to live in is simple. I enter in by faith in the Son, and then I walk in obedience to the today word as he speaks to me in my walk with him. Amen. He begins after that verse a dissertation on just exactly how we walk in that rest in our Sabbath, Jesus Christ. And he does it by continuing his comparison to the law. And in this case, he's going to take us up to the end of this chapter, where so far he's talked about how Jesus came as a human being and he learned obedience by the things that he suffered and is able to feel like we are, just like Aaron was, because he was taken from among men. He could sympathize with the feelings and the problems of the people, and Jesus became one of us and he can sympathize. He's going to make that case again as he comes to the end of this chapter. And of course, verse 16 is one of those great crescendo verses that we preach out of a lot. Come boldly to the throne of grace. I find mercy and grace to help. And anybody that can't preach that needs to turn his papers in. You know? But the. And then in chapter 5, he's going to talk about, how much greater the priesthood of Jesus Christ is than the priesthood of Aaron, because he's not just one who can sympathize with the feelings of our infirmities, but he's a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Amen. So we'll get to that next time. But this passage is telling us some interesting things about living in the rest that the Lord Jesus has purchased for us. And he gives us this 12th and 13th verses, which once again are two verses we like to yank out of its context and prove all kinds of interesting subjects. But let's read 12 and 13 together. For, that is, we want to work hard to enter this rest, for or because the Word of God is alive and powerful. King James says quick and powerful. It doesn't mean it's fast. It means it's alive. Amen. It's alive and powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. It, the Word of God, exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before His eyes, and He is the one to whom we are accountable. The Word of God, as he uses it here, is not referring to the Word incarnate, the Lord Jesus Christ particularly. He's talking about the message that we're talking about. Remember, we went back to the beginning of this chapter, talking about they heard the message just like we hear the message. And of course, the Son of God is the message. But he's talking about what they heard preached here. The Word of God is the message spoken by God. Here, referring specifically to the announcement of the rest that we can cease from our own works. He tells us that the Word pierces and exposes. Amen. Amen. Every word of God that he speaks to us does this when it moves from ink to spirit. We have a tendency when we read this verse, and I'm just as guilty as the next preacher, you know, to pull it out of its context and prove all kinds of things about the written word. But he wasn't necessarily, they weren't walking around with New Testaments under their arm back then. He was speaking to them about the message they heard preached. Amen. But I think we could apply this to the word that's we carry around under our arm, don't you? He said that word divides between soul and spirit. I've always believed that the Word of God is the way we discern between what we're thinking and feeling and what's coming from the Holy Ghost to our heart. Most people have a really difficult time making that differentiation. Anybody old enough to remember the Memorex cassette tape commercials with Ella Fitzgerald, and she would sing this horribly high note, and the little goblet on the counter would shatter, you know, from, the announcer would say, "Is it live or is it Memorex?" And that's the way most people are about the Lord. They come and ask me, you know, "Do you think that's God or is it just me?" You know, did I just think that up, or do you think that's the Lord? Well, he tells us here that if we want to discern between our soul, our mind, our emotions, and the spirit, then the Word of God is certainly a place we can go to do that. We cut past our thoughts. We cut past our self-will. We cut past our feelings. How many of you know feelings are a wonderful thing as long as they're lined up with the Word? And they go the other direction, they can be something less than a blessing. The Word of God helps us to discern between our own thoughts, self-will, and our emotions, and that which is truly of the Spirit. Remember John 6:63, the Lord spoke to them as they, remember what they were arguing about in John chapter 6? That's where he told them, "If you'll eat my flesh and drink my blood," right? And he freaked a whole bunch of them out. A bunch of them left after that because they thought that cannibalism was a little out of line. But if they'd have hung around long enough with the few guys that stayed with him, they would have got to verse 63. They didn't know they were going to verse 63. They thought he was just talking. But in verse 63 in our Bibles, it says this. He said, "It's the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life." When he was talking about eating his flesh and drinking his blood, he wasn't talking about physical flesh and blood. He was talking about believing the word on that subject that he spoke to them, but they didn't wait around long enough for him to explain what he was talking about. "But the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life." The words that what? I speak to you. The words that he speaks to you are spirit and they are life. The words on the page in your Bible are ink. Amen. But the Holy Spirit of God who wrote and inspired those words on the page of your Bible come alive when he uses them to speak to you. Amen. There are a lot of people that can quote the Bible, but they don't have any clue what spirit and life means. They are spirit and they are life. The words that I speak, the words that he takes and makes alive in our spirit, they are spirit and life to us. 2 Timothy chapter 3, you're familiar with that, I'm sure. I'm going to read to you from Young's literal translation. Our usual rendition of 2 Timothy 3:16 is all Scripture is inspired by God, right? The Young's literal translation says every writing is God-breathed and profitable for teaching, for conviction, for setting right, for instruction that is in righteousness. The Message Bible says every part of Scripture is God-breathed and useful one way or another, showing us truth, exposing our rebellion, correcting our mistakes, and training us to live God's way. Hallelujah. I kind of like that. So he gives us four things here that the God-breathed Scripture does for us. The word inspired, you know, even the English word kind of gives it away, doesn't it? What is the word inspire? Where does that come from? Yeah, from respirations. Inspire is breathing in. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I like that, don't you? When the Scripture comes alive to me, I breathe in. Hallelujah. Glory. So every Scripture, all Scripture is God-breathed. Amen. And it does four things he lists here for us. The first one is simple doctrine. It teaches us truth, doesn't it? That's essentially something that ministers to our head, doesn't it? Amen. When we teach sound doctrine, we're learning truth. Thank God for that. Nothing wrong with that. We ought to have sound doctrine. Then he says this, and we don't preach on this part very often. He says that it shows us or convicts us where we're wrong. Uh-oh. Message says exposing our rebellion. Yeah. Like that much. Yeah. But the word that he uses there literally means to point out where you're wrong. Anybody ever been wrong? He shows us where we're... I think that he tends to use the Word of God for us in this context to point out those places where we're still holding out on him. Anybody ever got... I won't go down the road and ask you to tell us what it is. But most of us, that's why they call sanctification a progressive work, because it's a progressive work in most of us, isn't it? We kind of give up the things we give up when we get darn good and ready to give them up, don't we? Or turn them over to him or let him have them. Isn't that right? Amen. Where are those places that you're still holding out? He said the Word of God will point those places out to us if we'll allow it to do that. The places where we're still in rebellion. Uh-oh. And then he says that it exposes our rebellion, corrects our mistakes. He shows us where we're missing God. I like to think of it this way. In conviction, he shows us the places we're still holding out. And I believe in instruction, he does what? I believe he shows us what we could be. Amen. Amen. Shows us what we could be. Shows us where we're still not achieving what we ought to be achieving. And then finally, he says, helps us to... He brings instruction in righteousness. He instructs us how to live right. That's what that means. In who we are and what we are because of what he's done for us. He shows us how to get to the place of what we could be and what he's designed us to be. So the Word does several things for us. Amen. He says it divides asunder, he said, the joints and the marrow. I have puzzled over that phrase now for 35 years, and I still have no clue what that's supposed to be talking about, because the joints and the marrow in your body are not connected to each other. The marrow's inside your bones, and the joints are where the interface of two bones come together. And so I thought, well, I must just be stupid. So I will look this up in a bunch of intelligent people's books. And you know what? They're just dumb as I am. At least some of them had the intellectual honesty to say, you know what? I don't know what that means. What he was going for there. So if you figure it out, write a book. Amen. And then he said it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. That's the King James. The New Living said what? He said it exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. The Word of God discerns or exposes what's going on really on the inside of us. A discerner means a judge, one that makes a difference between two alternatives. Amen. So the Word of God then illuminates and exposes the condition and the inclinations of the heart of man. I know this is not any news to you, but God is interested in transforming even our stinky motives. Anybody ever had stinky motives? Amen. Dropped one of those hints to somebody, you know. Amen. Come on. I think he's telling us here, and you don't hear this preached just a great deal out of Hebrews 4:12, but I think his point here is that the Word of God will come and expose the places in our heart where we could still use a little work. Amen. Aren't you glad he does it in our heart and not on the blackboard in the foyer? Amen. When we open ourselves to the Word of God, we expect to see things. He lays bare our hearts. The Word, the message preached, lays bare our hearts and makes us aware. He said in verse 13 that we are naked before Him. You see, he's zeroing in here on the real difference between law and grace. I always say it this way. Grace is a lot harder on you than law. In this sense, with law, you got a list of do's and don'ts, and you can check those babies off during the day and then go do whatever you want to do. That's the way most people approach it, you know. You can keep the law in the strictest sense without your heart ever necessarily being touched. Amen. Grace, however, gets a whole lot more personal because he starts messing with your insides. Amen. We are naked before Him, he said in verse 13. And he says that we are naked and open to the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. Do what? There's no creature hidden from His sight, but all things are naked and open to Him to whom we must give account. I've never heard, I don't think, I don't want to lie, I don't recall, let me put it that way, ever hearing anybody preach that verse. Because there's a lot of things in that verse we don't really relish. First of all, that means that the thoughts and intents of your heart are open to God, whether you like it or not. You can't hide them. Amen. You think you can sometimes. Under the law, people thought they could, but under grace, now you've got the Holy Spirit living on the inside of you, and He just messes with you. It's His job. And He seems to be saying that we will all be at some point accountable to this God that can see the thoughts and intents of our heart. Hallelujah. I believe, personally, I've been thinking about it a lot lately as I watch the world crumbling around it. And the church seems to be taking the lead in that. Huge international organization just this last couple of weeks decided that they were going to rethink their position on homosexual behavior. That we just have to change with the times. Well, my. But you know, it's been going on for decades. It didn't just start today. But one of the things that we don't preach too much anymore, that's why I had that song on my mind. I was thinking about brother, there's a reckoning a coming in the morning. You better get ready for I'm giving you the warning. Amen. Ain't nobody giving the warning anymore. There is a day of reckoning a coming. Amen. And sometimes we, I think we don't mention that quite often enough anymore. You know, just in the last decade or so, we did away with hell. I say we, I use that term advisedly. Somebody tried to do away with it. I'm not on board with it. I'm not going. But somebody is. Amen. We are naked before Him, and we will be accountable before Him at some point with what we do, with what He points out to us about the thoughts and intents of our heart. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Speaking to Pastor Timothy in the church that is at Ephesus, and coming right after 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, where he said all Scripture is given by God, amen, inspired by God, and then he said it's also so that the man of God may be prepared and fully equipped for every good work, amen. Then in chapter 4 begins the next verse. I solemnly urge you, in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead, when He appears to set up His kingdom, preach the Word of God. Be prepared, whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage your people with good teaching. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. Amen. Paul wants to reach down from heaven right now and punch the I told you so button. It said they will follow, listen to this, their own desires. And will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject truth and chase after myths. He told the pastor to preach the word, give them sound teaching that would bring about correction, rebuke, and encouragement. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine, the King James said. I think maybe we missed it when we got off the King James. You know, when you heard reprove, rebuke, and exhort, you just knew what you were supposed to do with that, didn't you? We started softening the language to make it prettier. Amen. But he says that Jesus Christ is going to judge the living and the dead when he appears, and the message to the pastor was, preach the word of God. And there's going to be some people that won't care for that. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, let's look there. There is a day of reckoning a coming. And it might be in the morning for all I know. I think that was Tennessee Ernie Ford. I've been on a Tennessee Ernie Ford kick here lately. We had 16 tons a few weeks ago. I saw Tennessee Ernie in person. Did you know that? Amen. Even before I saw the Jefferson airplane. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. So whether we are here in this body or away from this body, our goal, everybody say our goal. Here's your goal right here. Are you ready? Here's our corporate goal. Our goal is to please Him. Amen. You can eliminate the rest of your goal list. Our goal is to please Him. For we must all stand before Christ to be judged. We will each receive whatever we deserve. Uh-oh. For the good or evil we have done in this earthly body. This is talking to Christians. Some people have done away with this doctrine. Because we understand our fearful responsibility to the Lord. This is Paul talking about his ministry and his understanding of his ministry. Because we understand our fearful responsibility to the Lord, we work hard to persuade others. Amen. God knows we're sincere, and I hope you know this too. It's quiet now. Acts chapter 17, let's look there. Everybody is going to get a day of reckoning of some kind. He says if you want to live in rest, you recognize that you are a son of God and that you can't hide anything from Him. That you're naked and open before Him, and you will have to give account to Him. Amen. Now, those of us who are Christians, who've come into that gracious side of Calvary, we can look at reproof, rebuke, and exhortation with a different eye than a person who's on the other side, where every sin brings a just recompense or reward. Acts chapter 17, verse 31. For He has set a day for judging the world with justice by the man He has appointed. And He proved to everyone who this is by raising him from the dead. There is a day of justice coming. Now understand this, that Christians will stand before, in 2 Corinthians 5 he was talking about the judgment seat of Christ. The unbeliever is going to stand before the great white throne. Small wars are fought about when that's going to happen, so we won't go into that. But somewhere toward the end of the book of Revelation, there's going to be a time when all the dead, amen, will be raised up. All the dead who are not dead in Christ will be raised up, come before the great white throne on which the Father sits. And if their name is not written in the book of life, then they will be judged from another book, according to their works. Here's a hint. You want your name to be in the first book. because then you'll be judged by Jesus' works, not yours. Amen. You don't want to be in that second line. Amen. So there is a judgment coming, but the unbeliever will be judged basically according to what he did with Jesus Christ. Amen. And then those who have come to Christ, who know Jesus, will be judged, he says very clearly in 2 Corinthians 5, according to what they did, whether good or evil, in this body. And they'll be rewarded accordingly. Look in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Well, this is not very edifying, Pastor. Oh, well. Get over it. First Corinthians chapter 3. This is a fascinating passage. Once again, you don't hear too much preaching out of this. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Verse 10. According to the grace of God which was given to me as a wise master builder, I've laid the foundation and another builds on it, but let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Everybody say, no other foundation.
No other foundation.
Okay. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it. Now remember, the foundation's been laid. This is Jesus Christ. We're talking about people that believe on the Lord, right? On top of that foundation, things get built. Gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. Go with the stones. Amen. He says, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. This is talking about a judgment for believers. Are you with me? This is that day when, once again, we won't go into an argument over when it occurs, because my opinion doesn't really make much difference. But it will happen. He said, it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. So if whatever you built on the foundation of Jesus Christ endures the testing of fire, whatever that means on that day, then there will be rewards involved. Look at somebody and say, I want me some rewards. How about you? Amen. I'm looking forward to a big reward ceremony. Amen. I want to be as close as I can to where John Casement is, because that means I'll be near the front of the line.
Careful now, careful.
All liars have their place in the lake of fire. That's in there too. Verse 15. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss. This is, dear friends, he's not talking about missing heaven. We'll prove that here in the next phrase, but there will be, for those of us who know the Lord, when we get there, if our works are burned up, we will feel a sense of... Did you ever wonder in the book of Revelation, in heaven, why it says that God is going to wipe away the tears from their eyes? He's talking about Christians in heaven, crying. Come on. They will suffer loss. That's Stokes' theory about why they're crying. But he himself will be saved. That in your Bible? See, we're not talking about him going to hell here. We're talking about some of the stuff that he was so doggone proud of on the earth is just going to fry when they get there. Toast. He will suffer loss. He will be saved, yet so as by fire. The New Living Translation says, the builder will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through a wall of flames. I think I saw that on America's Got Talent or something. Anyway, clearly to me, he's talking about a day of judgment for believers when their works here in this earth will be tried by fire, and there will be reward based on that which was done in such a way as to be long-lasting, and that there will be loss for those works that are burnt up. Amen. See, I don't know. I have no clue how that's going to work, so don't ask me. And the guy that got up and preached that he did doesn't know either, so just pray for him. But I do know that the picture there is clear that there's going to be a test of some sort to discover whether your works were wrought in Christ or not. Amen. And that there will be reward for those that were. Glory to God. Amen. So, well, let's read verse 16 just for the fun of it. If anyone's work is burned, he'll suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Verse 16. Do you not know that you, he's talking about the whole church, you, it's a plural you, you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you. If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. He's talking about people that do damage to the church. So I don't want to be in that line either, do you? Amen. So, the question then becomes, of course, what works are gold, silver, and precious stones? What works are wood, hay, and stubble? What's going to get burned up? Or I guess that's the question. Isn't that your question? That's my question when I read that passage. Amen. So how do we determine those things? Well, I think here in Hebrews 4, he's given us a clue. He said, everything is naked and open before him to whom we will have to give account. Nothing's hidden from him. He's a discerner. The Word of God is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of our heart. I think he's given us a clue. I think that works that are done with motives other than obedience, faith, and love probably are going to be in the wood, hay, and stubble department. Amen. I mean, I don't pretend to have an exhaustive list of the intents of the heart that God's not happy about, but I don't know about you, but I'd have to plead guilty to some things, wouldn't you? Come on. Amen. So, what's he saying? He said, we can rest when we come before the Lord if we have laid the foundation of Jesus Christ and allow him to bring correction to our hearts regarding our motives, because we're not what? We're not fearful about going to hell. But our desire is for him to get us right. Are you listening to me? People that don't have that attitude, you know, John talked about it in John chapter 3, Jesus quoting Jesus in the 18th verse. He said, there's no judgment against anyone who believes in him, but anyone who does not believe in him has already been judged for not believing God's one and only Son. And the judgment is based on this fact. God's light came into the world, but people loved darkness more than the light. Why? For their actions were evil. All who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it, for fear their sins will be exposed. But those who do what is right come to the light, so others can see that their works are wrought in God. Amen. My wife has a favorite phrase. She said, to the extent that your secret, you're sick. She's real big on transparency. If any of you know Judy, you don't have to wonder what she's thinking. Amen. But there's a spiritual truth in there. Amen. And I believe all of us at some point along the way have those places in our heart where we're trying to hide them from the light. Not just from people around us. You know, people are, not that I don't care what people think. In my business, you really need to care a little bit. You know. But, And we should care what people think. We want to be a good witness. We want to put ourselves in a position to be a blessing to people if we can. And if they can't stand the sight of you, you're going to have a hard time. So we try to be somewhat gracious, you know. But the real issue is when you're by yourself, just you and the Lord, and you get really, really honest, can you stand to be quiet before him, or do you have to turn on the radio? You understand what I'm saying? I think a lot of people just try to keep life noisy because if they get real quiet, that light starts hitting those places they're trying to hide. I do. Stay there long enough for to complete the surgery. Don't get up while you're still wide open. He's a wonderful surgeon. Amen. But if he's using that sharp two-edged sword to clean out your heart, stay there till he's done. Let him sew you back up before you try to go back out. Amen. But a lot of folks just have those places that they really don't trust him with yet. I had somebody tell me just recently, you know, said, I'm not sure I'm ready to give that up yet. I said, well, I'm going to sing that song to him. Better get ready. Amen. There's a reckoning coming. And you know what? His desire for you in whatever area that is always better than yours. You know? We always have this notion, well, I don't think I can give that up. I don't know what I'll do without it. You'll get blessed without that. That's what you'll do. Amen. Turn it over to somebody that can actually do something with it and get on about your business. Amen. So, there will be a day of reckoning, a day of for us as Christians, not of deciding whether we're going to go to heaven or hell, but of deciding what our reward shall be. And for some of us, there will be, probably for all of us, there will be certain areas where we get a little burning done, you know. Just a slight smell of smoke. I'm hoping to keep it slight anyhow. How about you? Amen. But notice, he's telling us here, as we're working diligently to enter into that rest, we let the Word of God work in us, revealing the thoughts and intents of our heart, allow Him to see, allow Him to prepare us for the day when we'll stand before Him. So then, verse 14, because we love to start at verse 14 and just preach, but what was he talking about? He was talking about when that sword of the Spirit gets to working on two-edged swords, working down in there and just cutting stuff out and removing yuck and whatever it means to divide bone and marrow or joint and marrow, whatever that means, and I'm sure it's very profound. Whatever it is, amen. I don't know if anybody ever cut up a beef, tried to divide especially the big bones. Man, you got to have a sharp knife, eh? Or a saw. Amen. But notice verse 14. I'm reading the New Living Translation in Hebrews 4. Verse 14 says, so then, he's discerning the thoughts and intents of our hearts. Our hearts are naked before him. They're open before him, with whom we're going to have to give account. So then, since we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy and we'll find grace to help us when we need it most. We pull those three verses out of their context all the time and prove all kinds of stuff. But what was he talking about? He's talking about when God has been doing that surgery and you are thinking, oh, no more, no more. I'm such a horrible person. I haven't... What do? Run boldly to the throne of grace. Amen. Amen. We have a great high priest who has passed, the King James says, passed through the heavenlies. Amen. Now, that's a powerful phrase. He didn't say passed into heaven. He said he passed through the heavenlies. He did pass into heaven. But the heavenlies is the atmosphere around the earth. Now, what was going on in the atmosphere around the earth when Jesus passed through it? Yeah, the Bible says that the atmosphere around the earth was filled with what? Principalities and power. Rulers of the darkness of this world. Wicked spirits in the heavenly places. When it says Jesus passed through the heavenlies, he's not talking about... I mean, he did eventually ascend to the throne and was seated at the right hand of the Father. Don't misunderstand me. But to get there, he had to pass through all of the forces of darkness between here and the second heaven, which is the heaven the celestial heavens above us that we see, before he passed into the third heaven where the throne of God is. How do you know it's in the third heaven? Because it says so in 2 Corinthians 12. Amen. But the first heaven is just the atmosphere around us that the Bible says is filled with what? Demonic spirits. When Jesus came out of the grave, he blew through the forces of darkness around the atmosphere of the earth and created a hole for us to pass through behind him. Amen. Light shone all the way to the throne. Amen. We have a great high priest who has passed through the heavenlies, and we don't have a great high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. What's that mean? He said, when we come to that throne, when we pass through that path that he has been the forerunner in taking us to the heavenly places, when we get there, we can count on the fact that he will understand every single weakness that we have. Think about that for a minute. That is the big deal about him being human in the earth. We covered some of that in chapter 2. Amen. But that's a big deal. He was in all points tempted like as we are, yet he did not sin. So that when we come boldly to the throne, we've got somebody sitting there representing us who is able to, I hate to use this word, sympathize, and at best, empathize with what we were going through. He'll never look at you and go, how could you do something like that? How many of you have ever said that to somebody else? Come on. Or wanted to, anyway. Come on. I could give you a list today. Really? But you never get that from the Lord. Amen. You have a high priest who's waiting for you to get there and knows how you feel. He said, therefore, because we have this great high priest, because he's passed through the forces of darkness, we're holding firm to our confession, to what we believe, and we're running boldly to the throne of grace. Everybody say boldly to the throne of grace. Hallelujah. What does it mean to be boldly, you know? What's bold mean? What does that phraseology mean? Huh? Confidently, with much assurance. The concordance says it means outspokenness. That you can absolutely say anything to the Lord and he will get it. Amen. I mean, I kind of watch my language when I go in there. Maybe I'm old-fashioned, you know. But you can tell him what you're going through. You can tell him how mad you are. You can tell him how weak you feel. You can tell him whatever you need to tell him and be as outspoken and plain. Why? Because you're building on a foundation of Jesus Christ, amen, and him crucified and him raised. It's not like you're going in trying to impress him. Why? Because he's already seen the thoughts and the intents of your heart. So we run boldly to the Lord, even when we fail, because we recognize his empathy for us. And when we come boldly to that throne, it says, you will find mercy and grace to help in the time of need. I'm so glad that the first thing we get when we get there is mercy. Amen. Aren't you glad? What's mercy mean? Mercy means you didn't get what you had coming. When you're pleading for mercy, you know you're guilty. You know you did it, and you deserve a whooping. Amen. But you throw yourself on the mercy of the court. He said, when you come to your great high priest, who is touched with the feelings of your weaknesses, that's what infirmities mean, when you get there, the first thing he does is give you what? Mercy. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. I needed a double dose of mercy in you. And I still do most days. Lord, have mercy on me. Amen. Mercy, mercy, mercy. Have you ever studied mercy throughout the Bible? It's a fabulous, fabulous subject. You know, in reality, that's the best we can all hope for, ultimately, isn't it? To experience his mercy. But aren't you glad that it's more than that? I mean, if we just got his mercy, it would be great. If we just didn't get what we had coming, that would be a big deal. Because at the very least, that means we'd miss hell, and that's a big deal. Amen. I believe if we run to the throne every time we find ourselves failing, that we can do away with a lot of that burning up thing on the ultimate day of accounting. We can go ahead and have him apply mercy to it now. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Let's save a little singeing on the way in. Mercy. But he doesn't say, you'll get mercy and that's more than you deserve. He said, you'll receive mercy and find what? Grace to help. Grace to help. But usually when we hear the term grace, we think about being God forgiving us even when we didn't deserve it, which is true, but that's really more in the line of mercy. Grace is when he provides something for us that we didn't deserve. Eternal life, for instance. By grace are you saved through faith. Amen. That's not of yourself. It's the gift of God. Eternal life comes into us by grace. It's something he gives us, bestows upon us, because of nothing that we did other than just say, I'll take it. Amen. But whatever we're facing, he's talking about facing times of temptation, test, and trial in the middle of our weaknesses here. He said when we get there, the first thing he does is apply mercy to us so we don't get what we had coming to us. And the next thing he does is give us grace to do what? Overcome your temptation, test, and trial. Whatever you need to get over that particular challenge, you will find at the throne of your great high priest. Hallelujah. He will impart to you whatever is necessary. Grace to help in the time of need. If you look the Greek language up there in that verse, he uses a term there for calling for help, boethe. It means to call for help. He said he gives us grace to help just at the right moment. Amen. Just at the right moment. Aren't you glad? Amen. Once again, the context here is, how do we live in the rest that God gave us? We learn to let the Word illuminate whatever He wants to illuminate. And when we see things that we don't like, we run boldly to the throne of grace. And we always receive mercy and grace to help at just the right moment. Glory to God. Amen. He said that's so much better than living under the law. Amen. So much better than being stoned to death. So much better than being thrown out of the compound. But it's also more stringent, because you respond to what he's doing in your heart. Amen. And it's always better to run to God than away from him. Even in your moments of most horrible failure, run to the throne. Why? Because the first thing you get is mercy. Amen. Soak up the mercy and then take the grace. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's stand up. Bow your heads for just a minute. Heads bowed for just a moment. How many of you would be bold enough to admit that you got some things in your life, a specific issue or issues, where you could use a little grace to help to overcome right now? How many of you? Okay, we're in the right room. All right. All right. How many of you would say, you know what, I need some mercy and forgiveness for the way I've got myself in this mess? Okay, same group, okay. We got the right people. Grab hands with one another. Let's pray for each other. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Bless your holy name, Lord. We bless your holy name, Lord. We bless your holy name. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just... thank you for mercy and grace, Lord. Thank you for mercy and grace. Thank you for cleansing us, forgiving us, relieving us of the burden of our failures, infirmities, and inadequacies. Thank you. Now, Father God, I pray for grace. Grace to help. Grace to overcome. Grace to even see the light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you for that. Pray for the people on both sides of you. Thank you, Father, for my sisters. Thank you, Father. Thank you for restoration and healing and strength. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Father, for cleaning out the wood, the hay, and the stubble. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for shining a light. And then giving us mercy. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It washes white as snow. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It washes white as Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you for these precious folks. Thank you, Father God, that they've received mercy and that if they'll listen to you, they'll find grace to help right on time. I thank you for it, Father, as I commit them to your care. In Jesus' name, amen.